We're gonna.
I see one other school committee member.
Okay, coming in. Well, that's it. Just for the record, we're gonna make some adjustments to the agenda to accommodate the mayor and some school committee members who weren't able to make it last week at the forum that we held. So I can start with the mayor so we can get out of here in time for a 7 o'clock meeting. Thanks for coming. Do you have any opening comments you wanted to make?
Not really. I mean, I'm happy to. I know when I talked to you earlier, you wanted to kind of understand the job or get a sense of that. Last week.
Paul was here, and Paul Spector, a councilman Spector, and Wendy Maza were here, and they both talked about their job, the job requirements, the time commitments, and I think that was helpful to the committee. And if you could talk about your job, I think we all have a sense of what the mayor does, but we don't really know. Casually. So yeah, if you'd like to do that, then sure there'll be some follow-up questions.
Yeah, I think the things I would emphasize, particularly since the charter change, because that really kind of clarifies it, is that Northampton has a strong mayor form of government. The mayor, the charter says, is the chief executive officer. So I have a lot of responsibilities and authority. And I only raise that because, you know, if you look at other, if you're comparing to other communities, you also have to take that into account. Because some municipalities, you know, there's a mayor of Worcester, but there's also a city manager who does all the collective bargaining and all the contracts and all the appointments. You know, the mayor is the political leader of this community, but it's a little bit of a different job. And so, you know, this mayorship is a true sort of strong mayor. So everything from, you know, the things people see, you know, the cutting of ribbons and all the other stuff, they see that part of it. Obviously, the budget is a big part of what I do. The capital planning for the city is a big part of what I do. I'm in charge of appointing all of the various committees. The new charter actually gives me responsibility for organizing city government and forming and reforming and organizing all the agencies and boards like this, et cetera. Collective bargaining is also sort of one of those pieces that people don't understand or see that as a big part of the job. There's school unions and there's city unions. I'm directly bargaining with the, you know, I'm directly responsible for contractual bargaining with our city employees. On the school, I'm a little bit more detached because I'm the chair of the school, on the school committee, and the school committee bargains with, you know, with the school bargaining units. You know, obviously every contract, every, you know, all the expenditures I'm responsible for, and then sort of the long range planning of the city. And also I have supervisory responsibility for all of the various department heads, you know, public safety, police, fire, administrative, finance, all those HR, all those kinds of things. So it's a multifaceted job, and then I have these other roles that I play as mayor. By virtue of being mayor, I'm on the school committee. I'm also the chair of the school committee. So I have that role that I have to play in the leadership of our school system and the school budget, which is a rather, you'll hear, is a fairly significant part of the city budget. I'm also a trustee of the Smith Vocational and Agricultural High School. So I serve on that school committee as well, one of five trustees. I'm a trustee of Love Park. I'm a trustee of Child's Park. I'm a trustee of the Academy of Music. So those are just some of the other hats that the mayor wears. That's sort of the flavor of it. You know, hours, I couldn't really give you a, there's no set hours per se. I mean, obviously I maintain office hours within the city government, but, you know, tonight I have city council, you know, the school committee next week, you know, so there's always meetings, obligations, and I'm also on call, you know, 24/7 for various emergencies that happen. If there's major, you know, fires or other things, my phone is by the bed, and I usually, the police chief or the fire chief, the DPW calls me to alert me to that, so I'm aware of it. So that's kind of the role.
You said it was hard to sort of pin down the number of hours directly. When you sort of roll all that together with all the meetings, all the committees, mm-hmm. all the organizations you would have to serve, do you have a sense of how many hours per week you're living in the city in this capacity?
I don't, it'd be hard to quantify it. I don't know, 60, 80 hours possibly. I don't know.
Okay.
I mean, it's, you know, it's, and then there's the time that I'm just in bed worrying about others, you know, what's happening too. But that's obviously off the clock.
I guess I'm on my best friends.
Exactly.
I know what I'll do
in the shower. Exactly. Yeah. So it's hard to quantify. I've never actually like kept a log or kept track of it per se, you know. It is what it is. It's a 24-hour job. That's sort of the way it is. I mean, not literally. I mean, I'm not working 24 hours a day, but it is one of those jobs that, you know, when the power goes out and it's and the city's, you know, dealing with whatever, I'm in charge.
I just wanted to add something because, he does all of those things, but another thing that he does that it's not even when it comes out, he does an awful lot of going into the schools and he watches presentations and an awful lot of things that are just time consuming but aren't for taking care of real business, but just the culture and the socialness of it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's kind of like a 24-hour
People want me to come to events. They invite me to events, you know, this Saturday. I've got a bunch of different, you know, a whole line of different events that people want me to go to. And that is also an important part of the job. You're sort of the leader of the community, and people want you to come and be part of whatever community event it is. So, so that's sort of the overview.
Okay. Any specific questions?
Yeah, I'd actually like to ask you, what, if any, other indicators other than economic would you think that we should take into consideration when evaluating communities? For instance, might we look at something like youth crime rates, bullying, or SBIFI and some other programs that have been involved in reducing?
I'm not sure. It's an interesting question. I don't know. I mean, I would think of the usual metrics around population, size of budget, composition of government, like I mentioned before, like what type of a mayor is it? I'm not sure how you could incorporate those other things into it. That's a really good question. I don't have a sense of that. I mean, I feel like Northampton's fairly, you know, on the leading edge of a lot of issues. But obviously I don't take full credit for that. There's a lot of people working on, you know, departments, committees, citizens working on that. So I'm not sure how, if you could, the crime rate could be tied to a salary of a chief executive. Although, you know, we certainly don't hesitate to tie test scores to teachers and evaluations and things like that in education.
We're trying.
Yeah, exactly.
We're trying not to. Better metrics.
Yeah. So, yeah, I don't have a good sense of that. I guess for me it would come down to, the same thing in the private sector. You know, what, you know, the size of the organization, the complexity of the organization.
You're a working mayor.
The size of the budget. Yeah, those kinds of things. Okay. Yeah.
When you served on the council, were you involved in any processes where you evaluated the mayor's salary and made adjustments?
We didn't. I in the time I was on the council, there was not any kind of adjustment made to the mayor's salary. There had been one adjustment made just prior to my getting elected, I think, Mayor Higgins, when Mayor Higgins was in office. But I don't remember there ever being any kind of formal process for doing that. You know, obviously, it's an awkward position that, you know, because if you're an elected official to raise your own salary, that's sort of not exactly something.
Actually, Mayor Higgins appointed a personal advisory committee that I was on.
Exactly.
There were two city councilors.
Yeah.
There were outside people like me who were like third party HR.
Exactly.
Directors.
Yeah. And that's actually.
We organized that too.
Exactly.
Which is the salary you receive now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that's usually how it happens. I know Springfield just went through a whole process and the chamber was involved and they were looking at, you know, their mayor and how his salary compared to other like size communities. And so it's that, and that's generally how it happens. But I was not involved in that per se.
As a city, both on the council and now as mayor, when you do benchmarking across the state, are there certain communities that you look at as sort of the most comparable to Northampton? That's something we've struggled with, is trying to find a good match.
It's also hard too because you've got, you know, like I've got one of my colleagues and friends, Rob Dolan, who's the mayor of Melrose. Melrose is like, I mean, in terms, if you look at our population and our budget, it's almost identical. But also Melrose is like 2 square miles outside of Boston. And obviously the cost of living is higher and the job market, it's a whole other market. So, and you know, around him, you know, town administrators are making, you know, $200,000. I mean, that's not, and so it's a different, it's hard to compare just like apples to apples. You know, obviously I look around the valley and, you know, there's other cities like, you know, the Holyokes and the Westfields and the Chicopees. I kind of feel like Northampton's kind of in that range. There's some smaller cities, you know, like East Hampton, and then you've got Springfield, which is, you know, the third largest city in the Commonwealth. So there's kind of like a large mid-range. And then it gets really confusing because you've also got towns, large towns around us. And, you know, like, you know, Amherst, for example. And so I don't know if you can equate those or not, you know.
Well, I guess something that's sort of striking is you look at the salaries of town managers, mm-hmm. and much higher than elected officials. And do you have any insight into how is it evolved into that, or is it always been that way?
Well, I think it's a professional, you know, I guess, you know, it's a professionalized career. You have some people who have, you know, MPAs, and so kind of it creates a market for what a town administrator gets paid. It also depends on the wealth of the community involved. And the other salaries in the community. So, I mean, it's kind of like superintendents. You know, we just hired a new superintendent, and we had to significantly increase what we were paying our superintendent to attract an experienced superintendent, because everyone around us was, you know, paying at a higher level than Northampton was. So we went through a couple of failed searches before we finally found someone and had to raise the salary to do that. So I think because it's professionalized, it's more market driven, I guess, and you know, mayor is a political position ultimately. And I can tell you, I mean, I did not run for the office to make money. I mean, that wasn't my primary motivation. So it's different. You know, it's not like you can shop around to find the best paying mayor job for mayor. You know, it's not like you can do that. Or I work in Northampton a while, and I go fly in Springfield. So it's apples and oranges.
Okay.
Yeah. So I guess the only other thing I would say is just to, you know, I do think about it in the back of my head that, you know, with this new 4-year term, and you know, I do wonder about, you know, going forward. You know, there's always been people who step forward to serve the community and want to do the job, but it does beg the question: would the salary inhibit certain people from taking the job? You know, if they were running a business or in corporate America or whatever, or if they were somebody single and had kids and had to deal with, you know, if you were doing this job and you had to deal with daycare and all kinds of other support systems, could you afford to do it?
So those, well, especially since you're not allowed to run a business on the side.
Exactly.
It has to be. I mean,
yeah.
You can't.
Yeah, you're pretty much prohibited from having outside income, really. Or having, like, a legislator can keep their law private,
right,
or things like that. And other employees can have outside, but you know, I have to. My only master is the city. I can't have any other masters. So that's the other fact. Yeah, I don't know of many mayors that consult or do anything like that. I don't know if they have time to do that. But yeah.
You can be an interim town administrator.
Yeah, I suppose that happens after people leave office. Yeah.
Mayor Bissonnette, I think. It's been
yeah. So.
Any other questions?
No.
Okay. Well, thank you all for doing this work. Yeah. I know it's sort of you guys have been working along and thinking about this stuff, and it's awkward for us because we're the elected officials.
Yeah.
We're not really supposed to be part of it, and other than we can give you our perspective on it.
No, and that's quite valuable.
Yeah.
To get your insight.
Yeah.
From your experience.
Yeah.
We certainly appreciate that.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. So I'm gonna go to my.
Thank you.
Yep. So. Thank you all.
Downey,
you're next.
Yes.
Sorry, can you just have them say who they
are?
Sure. I'm Downey Meyer, and I am the Ward 7 School Committee Representative. Formerly on the Conservation Commission, is that why you were
currently
out?
Currently on the Conservation Commission.
Currently on the Conservation Commission. I thought you looked familiar.
Yeah.
So the school committee is a job that I think
You have your monthly meetings, and those, though we try to keep those to 4 hours, they sometimes run to 1 o'clock in the morning, so they get to be 6 hours. That's your, just, that's your time sitting in the seat. That doesn't include your time preparing, and of course, when we come and vote on the consent agenda, where we have contracts, of course, we were expected to do any of our due diligence on the contracts prior to getting there. Same thing with field trip requests. So there's considerable preparation time, especially also if we're voting on a school committee policy. And when you get the packet a week prior, usually that would be a time when we would follow up if we want more information, so we'd be communicating with Laura Judd, who is staff of both the superintendent and the school committee. So that's the regular cycle of things. In addition to what's on the agenda and the documents that we have to deal with, there's also, when issues are important to the community, for instance, school start time, there's a significant amount of time that is spent communicating with the public and various constituencies about issues that are very important to them. So, you know, it can take me an hour just to draft one response, because which is, you know, a dump that I think, oh, that was a long time. But you don't want to dash something off. People are very invested in issues. People are very invested in their children's education, and so, you know, that element of communicating with constituents. Some weeks it's zero because no one's communicating with you. Some weeks it's 5 hours. Some weeks it can be more. Again, very much depending on what issues are coming before the school committee at that time. Those are things that all school committee members do. I've also been on the negotiating committee since 2011. And we just came to a renewal, the end of our 3-year cycle with all of our units, all 5 units. That was weekly or bi-weekly meetings, usually lasting from 5 to 7. I am not currently a member of a bar association, but I work as an attorney. So I'm reviewing all of those documents with an eye to mass labor law, and with an eye to, you know, again, reviewing, going into, I prepared trend lines going back to 2002 from our end of year reports that we filed with DESE to get a sense of exactly what's happening with our budget, so that I can make a presentation to the association and say, you know, this is where all of our cost items have gone, this is what the city appropriation has done, this is what the cherry sheet has done. So, you know, to make that presentation was probably 15 hours of research and preparation to make it coherent, because obviously you're not going to do that off the cuff. If you say something that's not correct or that they don't think is well-founded, then they're going to have your head on a platter. So, so that was pretty intense, and that ran from, we began meeting in April, and we wound things up in August. And again, you know, that responsibility, when things are being finalized, I'm actually taking phone calls and have, you know, going back and forth over language with the attorneys that are, you know, our counsel, our labor counsel, on, you know, during the day, sometimes 3 times, sometimes 4 times, back and forth, saying this language looks good, this can we tweak slightly, and also having phone calls back and forth with the head of the association. That's not something that every school committee member does. There are currently 2 of us on that subcommittee.
Let me just clarify. So you're intimately involved in the negotiations between the superintendent's office and the labor union?
Well, or
how does the school committee get sucked into that?
We don't get sucked into it. We are the schools.
Right.
The superintendent, actually, in their contract, it says one of the things you do not do as a superintendent is negotiate.
The school committee is the collective bargaining agent.
Yeah,
the school
union.
So okay. It doesn't matter where you are.
Okay.
That's
okay.
How that works.
Right. Absolutely. So it's our primary responsibility. We look to the superintendent for guidance on whether or not particular language on staff responsibilities is something that is going to work operationally. But as far as finance, we're looking to the business manager. I'm also in communication with the city business manager,
and with the mayor to say, you have the big picture of where the city's going financially over the next 4 to 5 years. This is what we're thinking of. Is this consistent? You know, and also trying to represent, the schools of Northampton to say, we would like, this is the vision of where we'd like to go. This is the money that we think we're going to need. The only way that we can attract good staff is to pay this particular salary. Also, that involves me going out and doing the same thing that you're doing right now. So I went out and looked at comparable school districts. You can go online. DESE has all of the collective bargaining agreements are online. They're supposed to be current as of October 1st. Some schools do a better job than others. But I built basically salary lines for teachers and, you know, put them all on a spreadsheet and put them all on a graph and said, you know, here's our competition. This is what, you know, this is where, if you start out in Amherst, your salary increases are 4.5%, and that we're pretty good up to 10 years, but then they continue up to 15 years, and we go to, you know, we don't go as far. So if we're directly competing with them for talent, you know, how do we change this? How do we do that effectively? So that's that part of the job.
Can I just ask you a question? So you're on this negotiating committee, but right. Is every other school committee member required to be on another subcommittee or not necessarily?
Yes.
So everybody's on more than...
So for instance, you know, Blue is our legislative liaison. So she's the one who...
And
Special Education Parents Advisory Committee. So all of us do, you know, at the beginning of our year, or actually now, it used to be every year, but now it's gone with the charter changes to every 2 years. We all basically volunteer for a number of committees. In addition, I'm on the property, budget and property.
So how many committees are there?
And I'm on rules and policy.
There are at least half a dozen standing committees. There's budget and property, there's rules and policy, and there's curriculum that are standing committees that everyone is a member of. But then there are other responsibilities, such as being the liaison with the Special Education Parent Advisory Committee, being on the negotiating subcommittee. What else is there? There's legislative liaison, and probably three or four more. I mean, I'm also the parliamentarian, but...
What is the range of average hours spent then by someone who's either on the least number of committees or the most number of committees?
You know, for me, it's tough. You know, it's tough to say, because I think that one other thing that we do that's not really it's the continuing education part of the job, which is that we get invited to attend events for our district by the Mass Association of School Committees, and I've been to some of them for our district.
Yeah, but the thing is, a lot of people don't go.
Yeah, a lot of people don't go. But again, whether you go to the Mass Association of School Committees, Blue went last November, or to the annual meeting. So, if you're trying to use the experience and the knowledge of other school committees, then there's that interaction. Also, we get newsletters from the Mass Association of School Committees that keep us up to date on legislative changes and keep us up to date on the budget process, that the budget process, you know, begins with the governor's budget and moves through, and we may call Senator Rosenberg and express, you know, or write Senator Rosenberg or pass a resolution expressing, you know, our feelings about a particular part of the budget. So that's something that, you know, I don't necessarily count that as, you know, like my mail, it's just part of sort of professional development of being a school committee member. For instance, there's a new educator evaluation system that the Commonwealth has just passed. Well, it's a long, involved document, but if you want to be a good school committee member, you better understand it. I mean, not just if you're on the negotiating subcommittee, but because I actually had to negotiate the language, but if you want to be a good school committee member, you have read that document, you've understood the direction the Commonwealth is going in. We had somewhat of a controversy about our middle school math curriculum come up, and again, we were weighing two models of whether we were going to the sort of classical math track of algebra, geometry, algebra 2, you know, trig, and then pre-calculus, or whether we were going to go to a more integrated model. And so again, you know, I'm also a teacher, and so this is for me, you know, important that I understand these things are important, that I, if I vote on something, that I'm well informed. So we would research that particular issue before it came to us.
And is there, my sense from just the headlines in the paper and the school committee meetings around budget issues, that there's a seasonality to your workload. Is that an accurate impression, or do things? I mean, you guys are meeting more often than once a month in
yes, May during right during budget season. The meetings do go to twice a month. Okay. And the budget season is now moved forward, but the budget season runs now from January to April, whereas before it ran from late March until right up until July 1st. So with the charter changes, because the mayor has to present the budget earlier, we have to present our budget earlier to the mayor. So yes, that is a particular that's a particular heavier period where, again, because there's never enough money, and we don't have school librarians, we have no library media specialists in any of our libraries. You know, so because we have holes that we're always trying to fill, there's the issue of trying to make the best choices, trying to prioritize. Again, you're going to be communicating with different teachers, with different principals, with different people in the community about what are the best ways to spend the limited amount of money you have. There are other things that come up. There's the superintendent search, which I was on the screening committee, not for this last search, but the one that ended up us in hiring Brian Salzer. So again, that's a significant commitment of time for whichever school committee members step up to do that.
So I know you say it's hard for you to judge hours, but listening to you, it sounds like you do a lot. You love right. this work, and yeah. you're really committed to it. And my guess is not every school committee member puts in at the level that you do, and that's just my guess. So if you can't give hours, could you just try to give us a sense of, like, if you're at this end where you really give a lot, clearly, you know, what is sort of the least you could do in the end of the school committee?
Well,
what would that look like?
Considering that it would be somebody on the curriculum committee.
Could you just say who you are?
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm Lou Duval, school committee at large.
What I find, I mean, if you were doing the minimum, you would be... imagine, I would hope that every school committee member would put in a minimum of 3 hours, maybe 4 or 5 preparation for the meeting. That's 10 hours a meeting. So that's at least 10 hours during budget season, that's 20 hours a month. What I find is that we all have different, sort of we all have different interests, we all have different relationships to the community. I don't go to as many school council meetings. Some school committee members go to more school council meetings, go to a lot of the community events. Because I teach, I'm usually busy during the school day, so it's harder for me to get to those. But Blue is very visible. For instance, the lead science fair with my kids go to school. She was at that event, and just to get a sense again as a school committee member, what are the things that are really valuable to our community, and what are the important things that we're doing to help kids get. Educated, I find that if people want to do the minimum, they don't stay on the school committee very long. Because it's not, when there's controversy, it's not all that much fun. It does look glamorous. I know it looks glamorous, from when you're watching us on cable television. I'm on the negotiating subcommittee. But that doesn't mean that when I bring something to the full committee with the other members that are working with me, that it's done. It means that now we need to make a presentation, and the committee needs to think about whether they can support what we've negotiated. Those are difficult. And again, a couple years ago when we, I don't know if you saw the videotape of the rally, basically saying, "This is Wisconsin is not Northampton." That was not pleasant. I mean, again, I'm a teacher, and it doesn't feel good to say we don't have these resources and we can't. support our staff at the level that we'd like to. But at the end of the day, we are the people who say no, or you know, make those decisions. So I think if you're looking to do something just a little bit on the side, I think there are easier committees in town.
But also some things I would say would be cyclical. So if you're having 3-year contracts and you've settled your contracts, you essentially have 2 years off.
Or you wish.
Your budget season.
Yeah, except we don't. I mean, it's this 3-year contract was the first 3-year contract in the time that I've been on the school committee since 2010. So
because they were operating in the terms of the prior contract.
Well, because we would sign 1-year extensions. But again, the you know, for instance, you say, I believe me, when we negotiated the 3-year contract, I was like, oh, it's so good, this is so good, they're not going to call me in. Well, I immediately got called in for educator evaluation, language, and what I just got from the mayor yesterday, or not from the superintendent yesterday, was the district determined measures. So as part of the educator evaluation tool or system that's gone forward, you have certain things that the Department of Elementary and Secondary Ed is going to look at, such as MCAS scores and potentially PARC scores when PARC goes forward. But then they also want the districts, the educators, to come up with measures that the educators think are important. These can be anything.
And that's a newer initiative about teacher evaluations that
right.
we're negotiating.
Yeah. Right. Oh, but no. But that's collective bargaining. That's
part of the collective bargaining, the whole thing of how they implement the new teacher evaluation system.
Right. So that means that, you know, from my perspective, there's almost always something that is going on. We have we actually have a committee that. When we negotiate, you know, when you negotiate, generally you're trying to, when we negotiated with the association, we were trying to get to money terms so that we could support within our budget, and we were trying to deal with the most important elements in terms of contract language and conditions of work and job responsibilities. But there is a long list, probably a full page of things that we are supposed to be ongoing evaluating. So. That I'm supposed to meet, you know, the negotiating committee and the superintendent are supposed to be working with the association president and with their designees from different units.
And how many months of the year are you actually working? Is it 10, 9? Do you get summers?
No, we have summer. We have summer meetings, and again, it will depend. Summers can definitely be slower, but it really depends on what's coming up. I think there was one superintendent search that sort of we were doing a lot of prep work in the summer to launch it. I think some things are easier. A lot of times, a big part of our job is when I was on the curriculum committee was hearing presentations from various staff about what was happening in the district and what were professional development opportunities, where were we going with curriculum. We can't do that during the summer. So that would be definitely something that would slow down.
I would like to add on that one thing that Downey does is he puts an awful lot of energy and time into really understanding it so that when we do have questions on the board and with him being a teacher and the experience of turning everything, he's very, very good at being able to answer the questions and break down. I mean, it really shows that he studied it. So I just want to say he spends a lot of time doing that, because if there's ever any need for clarification, it's Downey.
It's just the regulations are very, are very dense. And I don't know that as a school committee member, you don't have, do you need to understand all of them? Probably not, but if you're ultimately responsible, I got an email a while back about a particular transaction that was happening between staff members and between a family. And it just, brought to my mind obligations about under FERPA, which is the federal act that governs student records, whether we were in compliance. Now, it's not my job as a school committee member to get involved, right, ever,
and the interaction between, you know, the principal and the day-to-day between the principal and the teacher, even though a lot of parents will come to us and say, this particular teacher is doing this, and can you help me? And I have to say, you know, there's definitely, you should talk to the principal, you should talk to the superintendent if need be, but we're not, you know, the school committee is, our responsibility is our budget, rules and policy, and hiring and supervising the superintendent. We can't get, you know, involved in operational day-to-day. But at the same time, because I thought, are we doing this, is this procedure within the district that's what is required by Massachusetts and federal law for providing information to a family when they request it, I did a little bit of research and then emailed the superintendent and said, not referring to any particular case here, but are we good here? And, you know, the superintendent responded and said, I think we're fine. He had checked with legal counsel. So again, that's just something that, you know, I think as a district, there are things that you hear about as a school committee member that they may not be accurately reported, but if they are, they may not, you know, are they necessarily in compliance? So if I think part of our role has to be, when we hear those things, to follow up on them. Otherwise, you know, for instance, a few years back, we had a comprehensive program review where the state, where the Department of Elementary and Secondary Ed comes in, and they review whether or not we are doing everything that's required of us for special education, whether we're doing everything that's required of us for civil rights, everything that's required of us I'm missing the last category, but that we had 134 areas that we were cited for non-compliance, which is not good for the district. It's not, it means that we're not serving our students well. That's one of the reasons, that's why our SPEDPAC liaison is so important, because the SPEDPAC liaison is dealing directly with parents who are interested in these issues and are advocates for doing these things properly. And, you know, that person who sits in that meeting then has the opportunity to come back to the superintendent and make the superintendent aware of what they're hearing. So, you know, it's an important part of the job. Again, we're not trying to get involved operationally day to day, but we are sort of gathering information and trying to pass it on to people who we think can act on it.
Do you think the current compensation package for school committee members is appropriate?
You know, I looked at it from a perspective of if you take my teaching salary and you divide it by the number of hours, you know, the smallest number of hours I'm in the building, it's about $40 an hour. And of course, you know, since teachers don't stop working at 2:25 when the bell rings, that's probably, you know, so it's a generous hourly figure. It comes out for what I get as a school committee member, including the health insurance that I'm taking advantage of right now, which I didn't take advantage of until January, so the first 4 years I didn't use it. I would have to work 20 hours a week during the year consistently to basically equal that $40 an hour figure. So I think my total compensation when I figured out was about $8,900 a year. I don't know. I mean, when the mayor was saying it, you know, this whole idea of the market, we don't have a lot of people running for school committee, and that concerns me a little bit. I think it's a pretty important job. I think the start time is going to start up all over again, because the American Academy of Pediatrics has just issued. They issued a directive that I actually, or sort of a position paper that I knew was coming, because I talked, you know, it was clear they telegraphed that it was coming. So that's going to start up again. So I was involved, and I've been trying to be involved. I took a tour of the bus facility actually down in East Hampton as part of my school community duties, because I was trying to figure out a way, how do we get good data about how many riders are there on buses? Can we do this more efficiently?
Let me just loop back to you said this year your compensation, you valued it at $8,900 before January, you weren't receiving any health benefits, so it's 2,500. Would you, do you have a preference sort of going forward, whether you would prefer just to have a lump sum compensation or to, because the number of members take health benefits, another members don't because they have jobs, they're retired, whatever. There's an equity issue that comes up.
And
do you have a, any strong feeling as to whether you prefer to take your benefits as part of a salary increase? Or
I think that, honestly, I think, you know, given the, given, you know, the availability of health insurance on exchanges in Massachusetts and the fact that, yeah, there is a certain lack of equity in that some people draw on it, some people don't, that that you can either leave it in place or I would think that you would want to increase the salary for all school committee members. Again, from, you know, just from the perspective of one of the things really important about the school committee that's not, it's not true on the city council side is continuity on school committees is a pretty important thing. The median tenure of superintendents is only about 3 years now in the Commonwealth. And that is a substantial cost to the district, not just in the $25,000 search fee, but in what happens to your district when the superintendent leaves and the new superintendent's coming in and trying to learn everybody's name and what's going on in different buildings and what the initiatives are that have been pursued. I mean, that's not ideal, and we're hoping that, you know, we'll get more time out of this superintendent in the district than we did out of Mr. Salter, who was, you know, here for a couple of years. One of the things that causes superintendents to leave is turnover in school committees. You know, you can see superintendents come in and they establish a working relationship with the school committee, and there's sort of a consensus about what are the issues that should be addressed. And if the school committee turns over really rapidly, you know, if four or five people step down and there's four or five new people, that school committee can all of a sudden decide that the highest priority is something that the superintendent had no desire to really pursue that they didn't. Again, start time would be an example where the school committee was really pushing. The new superintendent came in, you know, Brian Salter was lukewarm about the change, but still sort of pushed it forward. And then Regina Nash really was not, you know, didn't think it was something the district could pursue. So to that extent, I think it's important that you do have some continuity. And if it's just, if it's a token, you know, if it's a token, $2,500, then I don't necessarily think it's incentive to put the necessary time into the school committee member. One other thing for me as a teacher is that I don't know that, again, you don't need to be a teacher, you don't need to be involved in education to be on a school committee. Certainly it would probably be bad to have a school committee completely consisting of educators, but I think it's important to have at least some representation of people who are in the classroom day to day. And that means for me, that's a cost of being on the school committee. Whenever I see like a middle school science job come up or high school science jobs posted, I can't apply. I'm on the school committee. And not only can I apply, well, I'm on the school committee, but I can't apply for a year after I come off school committee. You know, so that doesn't apply to everyone, but that's probably the most significant cost for me. Is that I would love to work, you know, in my community and, you know, teach kids that I see coaching.
Just one quick question.
Sure.
It seems to me that there's a little bit of a disconnect with what you're saying. You're saying on one hand that you should have increased numbers running, but there should be still greater continuity. How do you reconcile those two?
Oh, well, you can have continuity. I mean, I ran as a write-in because I hit a moose and didn't get my papers filed in time, and I won with 62 votes. That, you know, which is, I mean, it's just, to me, I wish there was more competition around the seats so that I wish people were more interested in serving and announcing their agenda. You don't have to run. You don't have to announce your agenda if there's no one running against you. You know, the only competition is for the at-large seats. And you know, there are three candidates for two spots, and they will typically have forums, but only for the at-large, not so much for, because I can't remember in my timeline school committee that I've ever seen a school committee member run in a ward against another person.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't necessarily think the competition will mean that you turn out the incumbents all the time. Maybe you would if they weren't doing the job. You know, again, you asked me what was the minimum you could do. If a ward got the sense, or people in the city got the sense that somebody was mailing it in, they weren't contributing, then it would be easy enough for somebody to step up and say, these are my positions, this is where. Again, you know, something like start time is very important. I think on both, there are some people who absolutely don't want it to change because they think that the cost of the district will be too high. Some people think it should change. They really don't get an indication of where we stand because we don't have to run against anybody because there's not enough, people jumping in. And again, I think, is money going to make all the difference in the world? I don't know, but it's got some marginal effect for sure.
Well, you said, or you described 2,500 as token. What would sort of transcend the token payment? What would exceed the token payment in your mind?
What would exceed a token payment? Well, certainly, you know, I look at the city council, and I think, you know, at least parity. I'm not sure, you know, again, why we're half of city council. I think, you know, it's interesting. The school committee is responsible for passing a budget that is directly responsible for about 40% of city spending, and indirectly responsible for about half or more than half of city spending. So, and you know, and we're intimately involved in trying to set those priorities and, you know, advocating for more money if we think more, you know, more resources are necessary, in a way that I don't know that the city council has as much say over, you know, line item by line item of what's going on in the city budget. So, you know, parity with the council would be great. If, you know, the recommendation was that we go away from the paying benefits, then I would think that you would want to have some kind of recognition for people who might at some point need the benefits, that whatever that would be, you know, whatever that would be for them, to receive an amount of money that's the same as what they would, let's say, buy on an exchange, like Massachusetts. So, you know, to still make it a component, but like you said, if you want to do it equitably, then some people would get it, and some people would use it for health insurance, and some people would get it, and that would require their compensation.
Any questions?
No.
Great. Thanks, Sam.
Thank
appreciate
you.
It.
Thank you.
Good work. Blue, do you want to?
Oh, definitely.
Sure. I'm the at-large person. There's two of us. Anytime a constituent calls, pretty much like Ward 7, they also call the at-large people too. So, as being at-large, there's a lot, the volume of conversation, of calls and issues is a lot more. I have always thought that there's a problem with the money, and because I've tried to figure out why nobody does professional development in the school committee, other than the reading of things, but actually going. And I used to notice that before I was on the school committee, I used to think, why are they not taking advantage of the basically professional development? You can learn about anything that they're doing. They have all sorts of seminars. It's a wonderful time. It's a great time to network with other people and other schools and to get great ideas. And last year I went alone. This year I believe I'm going, the superintendent's going, but I'm hoping that somebody else on the committee goes. And I think that something needs to be done to get people so that they take that aspect of the job more seriously. It's probably time. Another thing is, I don't often see other school committee members at school functions or out in the community. I mean, there are some that are, but there are some that aren't. And I think that it's not doing the position fair. So I don't know how that could get rectified. That was another issue that I had there.
Well, just to clarify, our remit is to make recommendations to the council on compensation for elected officials. So we're really kind of focused on compensation issues alone. I think those issues are interesting. I'm not sure.
But what I'm saying is that's an awful lot of time. If we actually did the job the way it was supposed to be done, then that requires an awful lot of time to actually go and do all of those things. It's not just the meetings. You know, I was also on the conference committee. I was on the, which is between the city councilors and the school committee. I'm the Fed PAC. I went to Day on the Hill. Nobody went to Day on the Hill. It's been an ongoing issue here for years that the school committee doesn't take advantage of it. I mean, as I was sitting in the audience, I used to think, go to these things, learn. And they're so wonderful to learn. But that's time that it takes. And it takes that time and commitment away. I mean, some people do put it in and some people don't. And,
Do you feel that if people were compensated at a higher level, that they would participate in more things?
I would hope that that's what they would do. I don't know. And also, part of our stipend that we get right now, we every year put $35 now into the spelling bee. You know, I mean, it goes to there. I go to the different auctions and things like that. So I'm paying $10 here for this to support the different schools because school visibility is important. I haven't seen other school committee members at open houses. When I've been there, I think Lisa Minnick in Ward 6 does occasionally go to the Ryan Road one school council, but I haven't seen the others there. And that's always been a big concern for me, and I'd like to know what it is. And people say they don't have the time. Well, I don't want to see the salary become such that we're looking at politicians taking over and becoming school committee members. But I just can't figure out why people don't put forth everything they need to.
Are these funded professional development opportunities, or do you pay out of pocket?
I don't pay out of pocket. No, it's part of the school committee budget.
Okay.
And as long as we pay in advance and everything, we get really good deals.
They're a member of the school committee association, so that's how it works.
Yeah.
The most significant thing, I mean, for the conference is, since it's Thursday, Friday,
it's Wednesday.
Since it's during the week, I get 2 personal days a year, so it's not really, you know, so for most people, it's difficult to get the time away.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the District 5 things are held evening, but they entail traveling to Ludlow. I think you have a very difficult task with the school committee because you're never going to be able to pay enough money to professionalize it, nor would you necessarily want to. But at the same time, if someone has always got another primary job, it does make it difficult to be in the schools. You know, if I'm up in Turner's Falls, it's very hard for me to be in the schools during the day. To observe things, it's usually we arrive at, if we're doing something school related, it has to start after 3 or 4 or 5 o'clock.
But some things do, and I still don't see other school committee members generally there either.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, I just see that as an issue.
So how do you come down on the issue of that we previously discussed about health insurance versus increasing stipend?
Well, I don't take advantage of the health insurance, he gets $6,000 more than I do now. I mean, so it's an equity issue, I would think. I already have health insurance.
And then I guess one of the things is I don't know the origin of the health insurance decision, but it might be. And one of those things that is actually less expensive for the city to support some people on health insurance for some amount of time, rather than
is everyone's stipend, right? Because then you pay it, out all the time. And so unless you're going to pay a portion,
well, it's interesting because
I don't know whether that was a way to save money.
No, it had to do with state law. Prior to this, if you were an elected official, you were considered to be an employee and were eligible for health insurance. And under the health insurance reform law, it is now by executive order of the mayor or by order of the board of selectmen that they can choose whether or not elected officials get health insurance, just like employees. So from an equity point of view, you can't say, well, he's getting $6,000 more. No, you're getting the same stipend. He's getting a benefit that you're not taking advantage of that has a cost to the city. But just like with employees, the employees who don't take health insurance, they did it through their spouse. They did it through, you know.
Yeah.
But that is that's how they came about, and that's why it's different now.
But just so you're aware, and I forget the exact numbers, but I think it's only 3 school committee members get health insurance.
Right.
It could be 4.
But you never know. It's just like city councilors. It's just like turnover in the city council. Right. The point of elected officials, there's always turnover.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But and there's a shortage of school superintendents, so they follow where the money is.
Right.
Or they've worn out the welcome after 2 or 3 years. Or they're using you to step to somewhere else. And, you know, what are you going to do?
Yeah.
You know, it's all of that. And volunteerism is down in America. I mean, the old days, people took it as civic duty, and it doesn't matter whether it's school committee or running for city council, all across the state and actually the country, there are no, the incumbents are not running against anybody.
Right.
So I agree with you that is a problem.
I'd also like to see productivity come up, because even when the meetings were close, like at Smith Vocational, I was there and another man, Alden, was there. And I learned some things that day that for months I wish I had the oomph to really believe in it, because we kept doing it wrong over and over from what I learned. And I was like, no, that's not right. And finally, way down into it, I was like, you know, I really don't think that this is right, because I was in the board longer and looked it up, and I was right, but it was something that I learned in professional development that just kept on hitting me, thinking, well, I must not have got it right, because y'all have been on here forever, and I don't know. So that was my first term, but yeah.
That actually is, I think, just to be an elected official, I think that, and especially when your role is not an executive role like the mayor's, when you're we're not legislators either, really. I mean, we usually, our policies are drafted in response to something the Department of Elementary Secondary Ed is mandated, or something that the superintendent has come to us and said, we need this policy change, or we need this for the schools to work effectively. You tend to be very deferential in your first term, and assume that the information that you're getting is perfectly accurate. And the longer that you spend, the more you learn that you need healthy skepticism and sometimes need to ask the same question of 3 or 4 different people. And again, that just means that you're actually, becoming more well-informed, but you're doing more work. Especially this is true with budget. I think that, you know, the budget book is 3/4 inch thick, and I think it's easy to assume the way it's been done before is the way that it makes sense. But again, you can look to other districts, you can look to other practices in other states and say, oh, we could have, you know, enjoy efficiencies here, or this might be a better way to approach this problem. So that does it. You have to have the confidence of having served on the committee for long enough to say, to think, I will say, no, I don't agree with you here.
Or go to professional development so you can learn from the facts there, because I mean, they gave me a whole big book that I had and went over the things that were confusing, and I just think that it should be more mandatory that people do that aspect. But also, just for talking about equity, the back to the at-large candidates, both of us have to get twice as many signatures to even be on. We have, you know,
that's 3 or twice as important.
Yeah, so they pay. but But seriously, and then three times as many constituents than calling one person, so pretty much every issue, because I get a lot. Over the summer on vacation, I have people, you know, that say, that write me in the different capacities, like as I said, liaison. I've got quite a few of those as the school's starting to get in, and it's, you know, it's just very time consuming to do all of those different things. Yeah. And there really isn't a curriculum committee. Curriculum committee, when's the last time it met as a committee? 3 years ago?
No, because I was on it 2 years ago.
And you met?
That was a decision, though, the committee made that in general they wanted to hear the issues in the whole committee,
right,
rather than have them.
So there really is no. So if you're on the curriculum committee, you're on a committee that really never gets called.
Or though that it's been delegated back to the
right,
whole
exactly.
Committee.
That's right.
Though that may change. That may change. Right. So, any other questions?
No.
Thank you.
But if you can find a way that would motivate people to go out and understand that there's four different elementary schools and they all have their own different cultures, and even the teachers are different and the environments are different and even the learning styles are different, you know, and I just think that that's really important when we're making these decisions, that it's not we're making a decision of all the elementary schools, we're making a decision of four different cultural environments within the city. And I think that if you don't know the schools and they're in the schools, then you don't know, really know. You can do all the reading and the books and the roof, but if you haven't smelled Ryan Rose School before they had the mildew problem, you don't really understand, you know, why anything. I mean, it's just, I just think that that's really important, is to figure out a way to get people who want to become elected, you know, so that there is a little bit of, so people have debates. You know, that was the other thing, is running at large. I had a lot of debates. So, anyway, that's what I would like to see. That's why I came.
I want to jump suits,
basically. Oh, my God.
I've been on, you know, Conservation Commission, Community Preservation, and if you gave me a jumpsuit that had a logo and my name, I would.
He's a hard worker.
You want a badge? A badge could be abused. Jumpsuit,
officer, I am on 3 committees. I'm not looking at you.
If I had the jumpsuit on, I wouldn't have to take the badge out.
I was on 2 principal search committees last year, plus the third one I wasn't on, but I went and listened to all of it and went into the teachers and all of that and was part of that part of it. You know, there's just a lot of things. I was on the late start form of the committee, which we worked all the way over vacation, February vacation, and you know, and also people are hostile and mean to you. They should get compensated for the hostile.
By then, how that you're in Syria, you can have your buttons for
punishment. You know, and maybe if more people went, then, I mean, right now, like 1 out of 3 students are going out of district. You know, maybe if we understood the students more at the element, I mean, maybe, I don't know what, but I'd like to see less students leave and maybe more of an understanding of how to keep them there.
Well, just to clarify, we received an email from Lisa.
Yeah.
She was able to attend, but she emailed us. So, so we did hear from another member.
Good.
Lisa wants a salary escalation.
Okay.
Well, she's been here for 20 years. She wants
23 years.
She
does a lot. What's it called? The collaboration.
Yeah, the collaborative.
Right, the collaborative. She does an awful lot on that. She's the president of the collaborative, and she's been working with them, and she does an awful lot. She's somebody else who, you know, does usually, you know, I've seen her at Ryan Road School, at the school council. She's very active.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, and good luck to you all.
Thank you.
So I guess the next item on the agenda, we didn't have public comment, but we have public here, so we can skip that. We had the Q&A with elected officials from last week. Oops, I'm on the wrong agenda. So the benchmarking data. We had talked, or was raised at the last meeting when Dennis was in here, whether job descriptions, school committee assignments, those sort of metrics could be gathered. I emailed Dennis and he responded. Do you have any further thoughts on whether that's going to be useful data.
There were talk of, the government composition, structures of the committees, the kind of work that each individual community is doing at the governmental level. Those were some things that came up. Demographics, population, those were some additional measures.
Well, I guess I still am where I was at the very beginning, which is really what Mr. Mapwood said, is I understand that people think, Northampton is very unique and we're different than other cities. The reality is, from a governance point of view, for populations under 50,000, the governance is exactly the same. It's about potholes, it's about snow plowing, it's about education,
it's different.
Well, that's why I'm saying is what he said, is that you're a working mayor. The 24 cities under 50,000 are working mayors. There is no city manager. They work with their department heads.
So they're all chartered as chief executive, like he described?
Right.
Okay, that would be really helpful.
Greenfield has the very same thing.
Yeah.
You are the chief executive officer. In mass law, it's the same thing. You can have a strong police chief or a weak police chief, a strong fire chief. It's the same sort of thing. My point is, the governance of the city is exactly the same if you're the mayor of Newburyport, the mayor of Northampton, the mayor of Gardner, the mayor of the things you deal with are all of those things. And although I like civic pride and people say, well, we're different, in reality, from my point of view, I'm looking at it very narrowly, just like compensation, and looking at it very narrowly is the governance is the same. So Newburyport has a harbor master. They have folks. They have all the, they're one of our comparables. Gardner, I know we disagree on that, but it's like there's Mount Wachusett Community College. We have Smith College. They have a ski resort at Mount Wachusett. But the governor is still doing potholes, barking dogs, zoning, conservation, preparing the budget, making appointments, hiring, firing, supervising the department heads. And so that's what I mean in that sense. That's actually what it is that they do. City councils are all the same. It's just a matter of how many city councils are there to do the work and how many committees there are. So for example, in Greenfield, like I said to you, there's only four committees, but there's 13 councilors. So one of the things that, when I talk to my city councilors is, on the one hand, I would have liked to have seen them doing the charter review, you could say is, either our city council is inefficient because they have way too many committees and they should combine committees so that they don't have to go to committee meetings, or we need to have more city councilors and you have a city councilor from Ward 3A and 3B and then you divide up the work. It was interesting with the school committee too, so they have subcommittees. The same thing as in Greenfield. It's like there's a negotiating subcommittee. It's always a couple of members. So what Downey was saying is there's three standing committees, and we're all on those three standing committees. And then the rest are sort of ad hoc, and you can sort of plug in and not plug in. So from the things you had brought up, although I found them sort of like what Mayor Narquette said, I find them interesting from a sociological point of view or from another point of view, but for me they have no bearing on the actual governance of the city and what the chief executive officer strong mayoral form of government has to do. And that's what I mean by working mayor. So when I did those metrics, like population, budget, all those sorts of things, because they are working mayors, people don't really recognize, it is unfair, like when I was saying, the hierarchy is school superintendent, police chief, fire chief, town manager is above there if it's a town, then it's the DPW director, and then eventually, it's certain department heads, and then eventually you get down to the elected officials. And there is that odd tension between, I want to elect the bum to do what I want, or I want to throw the bum out when they're not doing what I want, and I don't think they should get a lot of money because there should be this public service. But for myself, for the people who were, like you were saying, like in Worcester, it's true, there's city, those larger ones, but the 24 cities that they put in there, they really are just like this person, dealing with the city government from that level. There is no job description for mayor. You know, you don't go to mayor's school, you don't go to city councilor's school.
Dennis, I want to just interrupt there. It sounds like the mayor's job is everything that the city administrator, professional town manager does,
right,
plus all the political
water
they have to carry. So
in the cities under 50, like...
Cities under 50,000.
Right.
And yet the compensation, he's getting a fraction of what an administrator...
But they don't have to have the professional qualifications of town manager.
Right.
That's the only difference.
I have an MPA, but, you know, town managers have an MPA. But, you know, you can have absolutely no experience and be elected. It's like when the mayors that came in said, well, what do I need to do for benefit? What do I need to do for this? And I was like, you are the mayor. You can never show up in your office, and you will still get your $80,000. You can never leave your office, and you will still get $80,000. You don't get vacation. It was like, well, how much vacation I get? You don't get vacation. You don't get personal. You don't
you're
get sick days. You can show up or not show up as you please, you know. And then obviously responsible people is, yeah, where is he? He's never in his office. I saw him on the golf course. Poor man can't take a golf outing. But of course, he's probably doing a golf outing for some reason, for a charity, but.
Well, let me just follow this train of thought. I understand they're not professionals, and yet, as voters, we're hoping to get professional caliber elected officials.
Right.
We hold them accountable at election time, so there is some accountability. It's a little bit different. Is it sensible, this is just, I'm throwing this out there, is it sensible to say, well, because they're not professionals, they may not have a master's in this specific area, but they may be qualified in many others. You could attract MBAs or other people.
Or they could have come from the private sector and they know economic development,
exactly,
which is a big
thing. Exactly. Now, does it make sense to pay them as if, because it's not a job requirement to have a master's degree, to pay them as though they don't, or to offer more money to try to attract better qualified people who have other options out there?
Right.
Based on economics alone, there's not a lot of variation between these communities that we're looking at. I mean, what was it? $20,000 difference or something?
Right.
I mean, I don't know that we have much room to go on if we're basing this all almost on economics anyway.
Well,
we're still talking about $20,000.
Well, it's not just the benchmarking. I think we're going to have to, as Trey wrote in his email, benchmarking is a component, and we haven't really had a big discussion about what we want to do with that data. But I agree, if we're just going with the benchmarking, you know, then we're kind of stuck with the mean and the median.
And
I'm not altogether.
And then you would have to say, where you're at. But this is the difference between the municipal world is not the private sector, which people sort of think, I'm going to run the city like a business. And they come in and they find out they can't do that. In fact, we make nothing, we produce nothing, we have no profit, there are no widgets we sell. The only thing the city does is provide services, and they spend taxpayers' dollars to do that. And that's all we do. And taxpayer dollars are brought to you by people. Mainly, okay, we need dump trucks, we need smokehouses, but basically, in most cities like this, as Downey said, somewhere between 50% and 60% of the city budget is spent by the schools. It's appropriated to the schools. The mayor has absolutely nothing to do with that. Some sit on the school committee, some people don't, but they're only one vote. Most cities and towns, 40, and it's the same thing for the towns, most things are 40% of the budget to 50 is really on the city side of it. And so, you know, that's just the way the budgets, you know, sort of come down. Same thing for city council. I mean, I listened a little bit to Wendy, I've known her for years. The reality is, whether you're a town clerk or a city clerk, it's all by statute. It's the very same thing. Business certificates, birth certificates, death certificates, marriage certificates, licensing of this, dog licensing, physician registration, all those sorts of things. The difference
the point she made was the hospital in the community.
Well, the difference is volume.
Okay.
So, but what I'm saying is, just like my argument is, from a governance point of view, the city council and the mayor, wherever you are, is the same thing. If you were strong here for the city clerk, it's the same thing. The difference is, if you are birth, death, marriage town, and those are generally the county seats. Greenfield is the same way. We're the county seat. We're the birth, death, marriage, nursing home. Everything is in there. So she is recording all of the birth certificates, and then it goes to the resident town. Now, if you're in Goshen, there may be 12 births from Goshen that year. The town clerk in Goshen only has to record 12. Wendy might have to record
800 because they're all born at collegiate, just like Greenfield has to record it because it's at Franklin Medical Center, because just like Gardner has to record because there's
Hannah Haywood. I have to disagree here. I do. I feel like, I mean, I think all of what you're saying is true, but I think you're simplifying the responsibilities of some of these roles. And just to get back to what Todd was saying, I have to agree that, you know, Mayor Narcowitz made a really good point before about who can run for mayor of our town. There are a lot of people that cannot run for mayor of our town at $80,000 a year and at 60 or 80 hours a week. Do you know what I'm saying? I just want to bring that back because I really appreciate your point. I would love us to just weigh in. There is a lot that goes into it, whether it's the same in every town or not. And, you know, just setting aside demographics, is that something we should factor in? And I think it's really worth considering the value of who are we trying to attract to these roles, and do we want to keep them and give them, you know, a decent living wage for the hours they're putting in? Because I could guarantee you, if you put his hours, you know, his salary at the number of hours he works, he has a really sad hourly wage. You know what I'm saying?
As many of us salaried people do.
Yes, totally. And he's not even getting a cost of living, is that true?
No.
So he hasn't even got...
And it's true, it's just one of the things of the political world, is like
right.
What Hugh Bryan said to him, is like police officers cannot have second jobs.
Mm-hmm.
The firefighters are in 24-hour shifts, they all run their own businesses and make more money on the side than they do as firefighters, although they're making $100,000
a year. But he can't do that, right.
But he can't do that.
Right.
And that is
but
a problem, is how you attract people
right,
to run.
Right, he's fortunate that he has circumstances that
right.
allow him to do this, but what if it was a person with a family or a person that was giving up a business or whatever? So we are limiting, our options for who can run for office by what we offer, and I think that should be factored into our decision on top of the demographics. And also,
I guess I don't disagree. I'm saying I'm just trying to simplify
what they literally do. Yeah.
And then the question is, what do we pay them? And I agree with you that he's underpaid. The city clerk is I've already shown that by the stuff we have and the stuff we gather. The question is, how much can we recommend given it's a political job?
Right. But the other thing is, you were saying there's only four standing committees in Greenfield. Well, we know there's a lot more than that for the city councilors here. I don't know if we can get that information, but that might be really interesting to compare salary in relation, you know, for example, for city councilors and school committee members.
They get no remuneration.
The other thing that was really important, what Wendy had said, was her lack of staffing. I mean, she was a one-woman show, and that I'd be curious to see what other communities have.
Well, no, there's an assistant city clerk, but she has two other clerks in the office.
Yeah, that was one of her points, that she supervises other people.
She does, but she does a lot of it gets there half-time, or they're not there when she needs them all the time. Just saying, I wonder how many other communities...
It would be a few interesting bits of information to have, like what is the staffing there, how many committees...
But it also depends on how the city organizes stuff. So, for example, the Registrar of Voters, it just actually recently went back into the city clerk's office. It used to be, the Council on Aging Director, Patty Shaughnessy, ran the registration in Greenfield. And so it also depends on what they do, but the core, who's doing the city council. It's our city clerk goes to the city council and takes the votes and does all the minutes.
Mm-hmm.
That isn't the case anymore, although they just reorganized so that Pamela, the assistant city clerk, is now doing the study, there's been the reorganization in the city. So it depends, the variance in the city clerk is, are they doing registrar work, are they doing city council work? But the city clerk work is the same. And then the question is how many, staffing is always an issue everybody wants more employees.
Well, let me just sort of bring this back, because I think the question is, if we had this information, would it be useful, would it be interesting? I think we'd be kind of curious to know the information. I'm not sure how I would use that information. I think there'd be a lot of noise, a lot of variability.
Which information are we talking about now?
Staffing issues for
clerk,
committee, service. What does that mean? I mean, people serve on committee, but Something Paul didn't say that meeting is that, you know, attendance at these committee member meetings is not 100%. It's probably more like 60, 70. Some people like Downey are fully committed. Other people are mailing it in. I would look at that and say, well, that's interesting, but there's a huge amount of variability. And I'm not sure that it's a, I know we're trying to look for sort of that perfect bit of data to lead us to a conclusion. I don't think it exists. And I think this is going to be tough data to collect. And I suspect that it's going to be very noisy and not a lot of strong signal coming through that data.
Inconclusive. Right, so I understand your point, but what about, for example, if we find out, you know, at a minimum, you need to be on this many committees. You don't think that's helpful data to understand that, you know, here they make $5,000 and they have to be on four committees, and here they make $2,500 and they have to be on two committees.
Okay,
you don't think that?
I'm sure we're going to get that. And that's what I mean by sort of the noisiness. We're going to have a sample set of 12, 15 towns, maybe if we can collect data on that
of the cities,
and then there's going to be a lot of variation, and we're going to look at that, and I think we're going to scratch our heads and say, well, there's a range here, and I suspect we probably fall, like, you know, it's a bell curve.
What do you think? We haven't seen it.
But I suspect, even if we were an outlier, and let's say we're way underpaid for the number of council committees people have to serve on, we're still back to the question, okay, you know, what's a reasonable salary given that, you know, as Danny says, we're basically paying a token compensation or salary to members of the school committee to serve. It's not, even if it's an outlier, how would you use that information?
Well, you're making assumptions about what we're going to collect for data, and you may be absolutely right, but we don't know what the information is going to be. What if we got that information and it was really clear?
Correlation
might be that people that had larger requirements maybe had a greater stipend, and maybe they don't. But to me, that would be justification for, wow, you know, in Northampton, they have to be on this many subcommittees. They should at least be making a stipend similar to cities that also have. Do you see what I'm saying? And it may be that we won't get that. I hear what you're saying, but we might.
Okay.
What I'm concerned about is that the number of subcommittees that you have to serve on our committee is not directly related to the workload. Some committees do don't.
Yeah.
Some committees
Summer,
really
yeah,
need
true.
Do
yeah.
something yeah. concrete. And so I don't
that's
think those
point.
Numbers are going to tell us
what
the workload
is. And that
is
a good point. I'm not saying you could be on the committee and just don't go to the meetings.
Don't be sorry. I talk too much anyway. I mean, part of it, you have to realize, that's my point about efficiencies. It's the reason that Greenfield has four committees in other cities is a lot of things fall under that umbrella. So they may have a four-hour meeting because you're on one committee or two committees, but if you're on the parking commission meeting and you meet for 45 minutes from 4 to 4:45.
People with full-time jobs are really not able to run for these offices.
It's difficult. You have to be able to arrange your schedule.
Yeah. But it's the current structure is somewhat exclusive, especially given the smallish stipend that they receive.
Right.
And I guess the question, which again we come back to, is if you increase the stipend dramatically, would that change the thinking from your perspective?
That's what I hear from Mayor Narkowitz and actually the school committee and everybody else. Is the question is, for me, less and less people are, that's what I meant by volunteerism. Before now, in cities and towns, it was like, well, it's your civic duty. And from, you know, 1900 until whatever, you know, and this woman was saying, you know, people have families. There isn't enough time. Everybody's scheduled. And, you know, so the question becomes for me is, if, and this is the same thing in Greenfield, is if you want to attract quality candidates, then you have to pay appropriately. Because if you have to give up your law practice to run for mayor, and you're making $150,000 a year as a lawyer, you're not going to run unless you have enough money to run for an $80,000 a year job. And there, or it's the same thing with school committee, even the volunteerism is down. If I'm going to put this many hours, if you paid them more money, would they volunteer more? But if they're working and they have families.
Yeah, I couldn't figure out that point because she was saying it was about time. And so to me, that doesn't necessarily equate to,
right,
if and you have more money, that you're going right. to go to more meetings.
I mean, to me, the mayor right. and the city clerk, by the data we have so far, is clearly underpaid. The school committee is a little more difficult, because to make it worth their time, then you have to make it a salary, and that isn't the case. Whereas Downey had said, they hold professional development on Wednesday, Thursdays, and Fridays. Well, anybody who's working is not going to take their vacation. I mean, they promised the kids we're going to Maine and do that. You know, I don't know how to solve that kind of thing. It's like when I was the elected member of the retirement board, the conferences, I'd have to go to pair of conferences to do that. Well, I was able to flex my schedule and take time off of work to go there because I work for the government. But if I had worked somewhere else, what would I do? Or if you work second shift or you work third shift, how could you run for city council or run for school committee because you can't take time off of work if you're working at night? Or you don't know how many people, my wife works during the day and I work second shift, or she works second shift and I work because I have to take care of kids. I deal with this in the workplace all the time. And I'm like, how do you people, I don't say it, but I want to say, how do you stay married? When do you see each other? But it, you know, they're flexing their thing to take care of the children so that there's coverage. And some, okay, and I'll be home at 11, then I'll leave for the third shift because they're a police officer on the night shift. And so I deal with that all the time. But so I guess the short version for me is, how do we have a compensation given the political nature of the job, and people don't look at it as you're not a town manager? Musanti, who used to be the finance director in Northampton, just got his raise, and he's making $150,000 a year. Yeah. Now, do I think Mayor Narkowitz should get $150,000 a year? Yes, actually, I do. Because he is doing more or less the same job, working with the department heads. But you could also get a mayor who absolutely doesn't know what they're talking about and doesn't know what they're doing, and then you could say they're not worth $150,000. So you can't make it personal, because you never know who's going to hold the office. And so, it would never fly if we said, we think the mayor should be making $150,000. You would have to really try to explain how is that the case. So I also look at what's the practical realities that we have to deal with. And
well, by practical realities, are you talking about the political expediency that the council, there's a range within which our recommendation needs to fall in order to be accepted by the council. And if we say cut everyone's right. salary in half,
and that's
say
why
no way. And if we say right. double everyone's salary, they're going to say no way.
And that's why the data that I got from the 24 cities has a huge range up to 100 and something. We have the stuff where we can say, actually, because of all of these factors that he wrote down, I am all of these, are all the things that I have to do, and the trustees. You can say, well, we don't think he should get the average of the mean. We actually think the mayor's salary should be this. We actually think, similar to, I don't have it with me, with this particular city, the stipend should be $10,000 for the school committee, or whatever we, you know what I mean? We have room to say, in normal personnel practice, the range is the minimum, the maximum, the normal hiring range is this. Based on the certain factors, you can go outside the range. And I look at it as we have enough data based on the stuff that they've said to us, and you can see where I'm going.
Yeah.
It is,
we don't need any more demographics.
to sort of recommend this is the data we have. This is the job they do. This is why we think they are worth more than the average or the mean, whether it's the city clerk or the city council or the mayor. And in fact, and we could even go as, in fact, we actually think that in many respects, a working mayor in a city of our size is equivalent to a town manager form of government. And we deplore the fact that.
You can make that argument, but I guess my question is the council going to buy that argument?
I don't think it's saleable to say we're going to double the salary.
Well, I'm not suggesting that.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, we could say is that we actually, I'm not saying we should recommend that, but I'm saying whatever the range is for the 24 cities, that's
okay.
What I'm saying, that's the range.
Okay. Let me go ahead
and I'm just saying go, it doesn't have to be the mean or the average.
Okay. It's 8 o'clock. We need to try to wrap up by 8. Are you guys comfortable going on a little bit longer, or you sure. want to sort of work through? Okay.
I have the
okay.
key. I have the code.
Okay.
A little bit longer.
I don't
want a 4-hour meeting.
No, I feel like
we keep getting a little off track. But I feel it's about demographics. Yeah. Do we want any more or not?
I think that's what we're circling back. Is it worthwhile? Or can we draw a line under our? I think we need to somehow. Draw a line under our benchmarking data. Because I think what we're going to find are the issues that Dennis and that we're all sort of talking about. There are other issues that come into play. The benchmarking data, we're going to use it to sell whatever decision we come up with. That's sort of my sense, that there are other non-demographic, non-economic issues that will play into our decision. But do we need to keep adding more to our spreadsheet? I guess that's the question.
And how would we get the data? I mean, I find it interesting what you said. It would be I find it interesting out of, say, those 24, say, whatever ones we choose. How many committees do they, how many, you know, but how far do we drill down as well? Who's going to do that work? How are we going to get, how many hours do you city councilors spend in Newburyport, in East Hampton? How many committees do you send there? How often does your committee meet?
How long
is it once a month, or we met six months ago?
And the interesting thing is, too, after listening to people here, my sense is, and I don't know if this is everyone else's, my sense is the people that are coming and talk to us are the people that are putting in major hours.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. And so we may not be getting the full, we're hearing about a spectrum, but we may not be seeing representatives of the full spectrum. Yeah. And so the same thing is true if we make calls to other cities.
Self-reporting is not always accurate.
Anyway,
well, the interesting thing is down. You said, well, to do the minimum, but then the question is, what is the definition? I would say the minimum is 10 to 20 hours a month. And then, of course,
But that was during budget season.
So it all sort of varies.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it depends on, well, I think everybody should go to professional development.
Right,
they
right.
should, you know, I mean, in. I know of some communities where school committee members, not a one of them went to, say, the high school graduation. Now, this is where I agree with. I find that deplorable. You can't even take the time to go to your own school committee to the high school graduation to hand out the diplomas. Yeah. On the other hand, it's June. If their family is on vacation, the kids, I'm sorry, my sister's getting married in Kentucky, and we have to...
I think, let me just sort of steer us back to the question. this will come up when we talk about the school committee, because I think the part-time elected officials, as you said, are going to be kind of tricky, because there's a lot of stuff in the mix, and things aren't necessarily working all that well. But can we just sort of come to some conclusion about this demographic? Does anyone want to make a motion? Does anyone want to propose? I mean, we can talk this to death, but what are we going to do about adding to our existing benchmarking table?
I said a minute ago, I don't know where you stand. I'm fine with backing off because I don't feel like other people want to go there. I'm fine with that. But
I agree.
Okay.
No, I want to add stuff. No,
okay, so we've sort of completed our benchmarking table, although I need to look at that because I think Trey dropped the median from his latest spreadsheet. And if it's not there, I'll ask him to add it back. He's got the mean. He's got the average, but he dropped the mean.
Well, they're the same thing.
No, one is...
No,
one's the middle.
The median is the one, they're half of them are below.
Right.
No, mean and average are the same.
Correct.
Right.
Right.
It can be if we do it wrong.
But yeah, so we're done with that, with the benchmarking.
Right.
And then we're going to meet again October 2nd.
Okay. That's earlier, right? 6 o'clock? Did we think we talked about maybe like getting pizza or something?
10-2 at 6 o'clock? Okay.
October 2nd.
And at that meeting, we are going to...
At that meeting, do people have suggestions? We need to come up with recommendations. I think we need to, it's crunch time. We need to go through the mayor, clerk, all the elected officials and decide what we want to recommend and what the argument's going to be.
And what communities we're going to need. Have we decided? Is it just these communities?
Nine. Isn't it the nine?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
volunteer, people volunteer to write sections of the report.
Yeah, we could even do a section.
We'll meet again a month later, and we'll scrub that and agree on it, and then we'll submit it.
Now, do we submit it, or do we need to present it to the city council?
I'll have to ask Bill Blight.
It might be helpful to know far ahead, so if we have to go to a meeting, we have enough notice.
I will find out, and I'm still a little bit, but the mayor
they
said
might have
that
questions,
they,
you know.
Well, the mayor did constitute us, but we're a council
advisory board. We're appointed by the council.
Appointed by the council, and we advise the council, so I'm not sure whether we go back through the mayor or... Glenda got back to me and said, where are you in the process? When can we expect a report? And I was thinking, well, I'm not getting a report to you. We're getting a report to the council. I'll clarify that
okay,
with the mayor.
Yeah.
But anyway, next meeting is just decisions. We need to really decide. And I'm hopeful. I think ideally we would come out with a consensus recommendation.
We would still have to take a vote, though.
Oh, yeah, no, definitely take a vote, I'm hopeful, and when we were on the charter, we had a judge, I forget her name, who sort of helped us walk through that mediation, because there are some people had very strong priors on a lot of issues, and we had to do a lot of compromising. So I anticipate there are going to be some issues that we're going to need to compromise, but some people have very, very strong beliefs, and that's fine. Let's try to sort of work on that. If you can't get a consensus, then we can have
or like tonight, you can have a strong opinion, and then you can agree to back
off
because you realize that not everyone else agrees with you.
Actually, I have a couple of questions about who the universe is of this. For example, before the Smith folks showed up, I had kind of forgotten that they were in. I'm also thinking of the trustees of Forbes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Are they part of this as well?
I don't think that there's one other office that's paid $100 stipend, but Forbes Library trustees, I don't think are paid.
No, they're not paid because I ran for the position.
Okay. Are they allowed to get health insurance?
My understanding is that they don't.
Okay, so they're off the table. Then. Okay. I just wanted to make sure because
But I will clarify that just to make sure, because I think all that we're dealing with in terms of salary and compensation are the ones that we've heard from. Mayor, clerk, council, school committee, Smith-Vogue.
Right.
I mean, there's the Oliver Smith will, those are all just, and even the library is under it's under the will of...
Yeah, and to be honest, we were created. This committee was written into the charter to provide political cover for the council, who find it very difficult to discuss these things. And that's why I was curious when the mayor was on the council. They had an opportunity, and I guess they did create a process to give the mayor a raise. But we're there to provide cover for them, so we don't have to give advice on. Perhaps not even on Smith-Vogue. They're able to do that because there's not that conflict. The big issue is the conflict of interest of council members giving themselves a raise. They have the authority and the ability, I think, as they've done in the past, to give the mayor the raise, to give the clerk a raise, and they're gonna have strong opinions about that. But it's really to address, I think, council and school committee, the part-time officials.
I'm guessing that they're going to probably want us at the city council meeting to ask us questions about what we forward. So.
Well, I think about my understanding when I was talking to Glenda was we need to write a recommendation.
Right.
It doesn't necessarily have to be a report, but I guess it will be that.
I think it should be.
Because we want to back up.
It's what the back up.
Our process and why we're making the recommendation.
It really is. What is our recommendation and what is
how
the rationale?
How do we get there?
And then
right.
I'm sure they're going to want us to.
Do
we also want to make a recommendation of some way to adjust the salary going forward, and then maybe this group is reconvened in 10 years or something?
Do we have some kind of mechanism?
I think we can do the mechanism. The reconvening is every
council.
It's in the charter, and it's a minimum at least every 10 years.
Well, it says a minimum of 10 years, but I think maybe you had brought up, Dennis, there's no reason we couldn't recommend that it's reviewed before 10 years. It doesn't have to be us.
Right.
It could be a new group, but 10 years is a ridiculous time not to get a raise.
Right.
Or, for example, Greenfield, just thinking about, which I'm not for, is, well, whatever raise is given to XY unions, then that's what the mayor's raise should be done on a year-to-year basis. But I'm like, that's, no, no, you need to tie.
You tie it to something.
I was thinking more CPI.
Right.
Yeah.
Which is on one of the ones that I, one of the ones that I...
We can certainly do that.
Leominster's tried to that, from 0 to 5% to the CCI.
If there's a consensus, we can add that in. I think that falls within recommendations.
You know, we can make a recommendation, in our opinion.
Yeah.
I mean, they don't have to follow it, but, in our opinion.
They don't have to follow any of our recommendations.
Right. Say we think every 3 years, it should be reviewed.
And so then we'll come at 6 p.m. October 2nd, we'll sit down and we'll just, we start with the mayor and then just work our way through and people will be prepared to...
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah, start with the mayor. I
think
the easiest...
You
think
it's
easiest?
Yeah,
I actually think that would be the easiest.
I think the full-time people
are more
straightforward.
The full-time people,
straightforward.
I think, are easier than part-time, but that's just...
Are we allowed to eat it?
We've eaten here.
Do people want a brown bag or do you want to order pizzas? I mean, I'm fine either way, but I need to eat. I'm not going to make it through a 3 hour.
If you're hungry, just bring
some. All right, I'll just get something. It'll be fine.
Because I don't eat until like 8, 9 o'clock at any time, usually anyway.
Well, we still have the minutes to approve. Did everyone get the minutes from? They were good minutes. Who's doing minutes?
Some moved. Some moved.
Second for the minute approval.
Somebody.
Second. Okay.
Aye.
Okay. Minutes are approved. So that's it. That's all the business that we have. One other issue. The mayor, when I spoke with him on the phone, he offered to organize public forum and help publicize it, use his office to get more attention drawn to it. And I told him that I contacted the Gazette and that
I was going to ask, that's what I forgot. Did they put it in the calendar? I had emailed you. I had some people contact me, I can't go to the meeting, can we email our comments? And the question is, well, where do they send it? Because I don't necessarily want my email out in the paper, I don't know how to have
people on the agenda that's posted online and in City Hall, my phone number is on there. So they should just contact me, I can give them my email number.
I can give this person.
Or you can give them my email address as well, and then I can distribute
somebody
it to everyone.
In the North Street Neighborhood Association.
Okay. And how did they learn about the meeting?
I don't know.
Okay.
I just got an email because I'm in the North Street Neighborhood Association. It was like, is there any, I understand you're on the committee, is there any way to submit written? So I said, well, you could give me something in writing to do it, or they wanted to do it by email. I said, well, you could send it to me, I'll bring it. But then that got me to thinking when I emailed you, if the people out there, in the Gazette, was there a way of, if you cannot come to me, send your comments to?
There should be a suggestion box, a suggestion at Northampton.gov, something like that.
Yeah, I don't know either. So that's what I'm saying, I didn't know.
I'm not sure we need to do that.
Okay.
Because I feel like we've had two opportunities. We're inviting people to send written comments.
And it was in the
put
calendar.
It
was
in
the
paper.
I sent a small press release to the editor. So I jumped over all those.
Okay.
And if somebody reaches out, we could accommodate them, if they don't want to do a written comment.
And certainly after we've made our recommendation, it'll be on the calendar for the City Council, and if they can have another, once we've got a specific proposal, they'll be able to come and comment on that.
Okay, I just wanted to throw that out there. I kind of agree, I think we've got a lot of input, and I'm not sure what value additional, it would have been nice to get more council members in here, but I'm not sure they got notice of this as well. I sent the invitation to
the... Yeah, I saw that it didn't, Lynn's, it didn't get sent out, something
like that. It fell through the cracks, and I'm not sure that was, you know, dog days of August, but they just got it Wednesday. It's been there, but someone hadn't opened it and looked at it, so... Okay, well, I guess we're done here.
Move, all right.